I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I'm focusing on preparation of the heart to be faithful till the end. Hello again, everyone. Thank you for joining me in the final session on preparing to stand. Throughout this series, I've been open about how enduring persecution can be very difficult. Now, in this session, I want to encourage you with some of the positive results, call them unexpected blessings that can come from this. But first, I want to summarize some of the risks and the steps we have talked about so far. In this series, I've highlighted four dangers that can knock us out if we're not prepared for the pressure of persecution. There's a danger of acting according to fear, of the heart becoming offended toward God, of pursuing pleasure as an escape, and of being derailed by deception. I've also suggested six steps that prepare our hearts to stand. Step one is talk about persecution. Adjust our mentality so we're not caught by surprise. Step two, develop fear of God in a right perspective. And this is the best way to counter fear of man. Step three, pursue the heart of God. This is the most important thing we can do. It underlies obedience, it fuels perseverance, and it's the best way to overcome offense. Step four, build perseverance. This is how we persist under pressure, and it strengthens us against the temptation to escape through pursuing pleasure. Step five, build community. And step six, guard the word. These two together are safeguards for us, our families, and churches against sliding into deception. Now, on to what we can expect if we put these steps into practice and remain faithful under pressure. I'm going to talk about 10 of these blessings. First, I want to highlight how persecution can draw us closer to Jesus. Number one, I love Jesus even more now because I suffered for him. I said earlier that what best prepared me for the trials I went through was my pursuit of God's heart, the years of building intimacy with him. Because I loved God, I was willing to take risks for him, to invest my resources in his work, to suffer for him. Love drives sacrifice. But I also found that my sacrifice in the end fueled a more intense love. As I suffered for Jesus, my love for him grew stronger and more committed. In a way, this doesn't make sense. I've been hurt. I was damaged. But on the other hand, I now have more invested in this relationship. I paid a high price. It cost me. And because of this, it's even more precious. Suffering for God can build our love for God. Number two, as I've explained, I felt very distant from God, even abandoned by him during my time in prison. I talk about it as experiencing the silence of God for 2 years, a dark night of the soul. And so I was really surprised when I realized that I came out of prison with a deeper intimacy than I'd had before. It's a different intimacy, one that comes from being tested. My love for God was severely tested, but I passed the test and came out with a proven love, proven to me, proven to others, and proven to God. And here's the result. It gives me a different level of confidence in my relationship with God. And God also trusts me at a different level now because I remain faithful under pressure. The testing and proving of our love brings us into a more confident intimacy with God. We can emerge as closer friends of God. Number three, I pursued God with an unusual desperation because of the pressure I was under. I've never been so God-focused in my life. I've never spent so much time praying as I did in prison, hours and hours a day talking with God, pressing into him, surrendering myself to him. The truth is that pressure pushes us to run after God in a way that we don't normally do. The difficult circumstances force us to run after God with desperation. I love this verse in Psalm 42. As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul longs after you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, the living God. What passion for God! But read the rest of the psalm. The psalmist is under tremendous pressure. He's surrounded by enemies, terribly discouraged, feeling forgotten by God. And so he cries out for God. Pressure makes us run after God as never before. And this is very good for us. Number four, I'm closer to the heart of Jesus now. I've mentioned already what I call the wave starter prayer that was so important in my life. Father God, draw me so close to your heart that you'll be able to trust me with the authority to start waves. This was my pursuit for years, to draw closer to God's heart. In this pursuit of intimacy with God, I especially focused on running after his presence, which is why it was so painful and confusing to me when I lost all sense of God's presence. But recently, God showed me that he had been answering my prayer throughout my intense persecution in ways that I had not noticed. Every time I experienced something that Jesus did, this brought my heart into a bit more overlap with his. So, for example, Jesus endured things that I also had a taste of. Jesus faced opposition, was greatly misunderstood, mocked and scorned, called evil, slandered and lied about, and persecuted for righteousness. He forgave his enemies and friends who betrayed him. He learned obedience and endurance. He suffered great stress even as he surrendered to God's will. And he felt abandoned by God and yet persevered. To some degree, in a range of areas, I have felt and acted as Jesus did. And this shared experience strengthens the friendship. It's almost as if we can relate to one another in the same way that people who've lived through the same thing can relate to each other and bond more quickly. There's immediate understanding that doesn't need to be explained. In some way, this happens with Jesus. Experiencing the hardships that Jesus did draws us closer to his heart. So far, I've highlighted that as a result of hardship, we'll know our God in a different way. There's so much more that could be said about this. But another result is that we bear more of his nature. And this is number five. I used to say matter-of-factly to people who were thinking of ministering in Turkey and were anxious about the possible danger, come with the assumption that you'll die for your faith here. It's very unlikely that you'll suffer that way, but come with that mentality, and this would startle them. I would perhaps say the same thing now, but I would do it with a lot more compassion, gentleness, grace, and humility. Now that I have suffered, now that I've broken, I'm much more understanding of the fears and frailty of others. Jesus is able to understand, to sympathize with our weaknesses because he was tested. Suffering changes our hearts, so we bear more of the nature of Jesus, who is gentle and humble in heart. Number six, suffering made me more sensitive to sin and concentrated my mind and heart on living for God. Peter says to the suffering church, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. I don't have time to explore how this happens, but I can tell you that it does. After paying a high price for my allegiance to Jesus, I recoiled at that which would compromise, dilute, devalue, stain this sacrifice. Together with this, I think that the battle to be faithful, the concentration, the focus, and the discipline this required, it trained my heart. I'm very aware that I'm sinful and susceptible to sin. But because of suffering, I'm more focused than ever on living for God. I highlight this because God is going to use difficulties to purify His church. And He must purify the church because Jesus will have a pure bride. Suffering trains us to reject sin and to live for God, a deep and long-lasting reorientation of the heart. Number 7, I learned perseverance at new levels because of suffering. The truth is that suffering builds perseverance. And this is so important to God that Paul tells us that we should even rejoice in our suffering for this reason. And James says, the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Allow perseverance to finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Every time we flex the muscle of perseverance, we become stronger and more determined. And this prepares us to stand in even more difficult circumstances. A friend of mine has compared the pressures recently unleashed on the world as swimming against a 1 mile an hour current. And God is using these pressures to prepare us to swim against the 5 mile an hour current that is coming, and even the 10 mile an hour current. Early in my imprisonment, a friend pointed me to some verses in Jeremiah. The prophet Jeremiah has been complaining to God, "Why are you testing my heart with difficulty, and yet others have it so easy?" And God answers, "If you have raced with men on foot and they've worn you out, how can you compete with horses?" I understood Jeremiah. I also had been complaining, but I really didn't like this message that God allows hardship to prepare me so that I can be entrusted with even more difficult assignments. Compete with horses? I don't want to compete with horses. But sometimes we don't have a choice. Suffering teaches us perseverance so that God can trust us with difficult assignments. Friends, simply being faithful to God in persecution is enough. That's what God asks of us. And in fact, it's a significant victory. But as we aim for this, persecution often puts us on display. Number 8, persecution puts us on display for other believers. I've mentioned how my mother said to me, "There's a long line of people who've suffered for Jesus Christ. It's a very long line that stretches back 2,000 years. My son, it is now your turn to stand in that line." As my imprisonment dragged on, I tried to strengthen myself by thinking often of the line that stretched before me, the great cloud of witnesses. I would say to myself, if they did it, I can do it too. But I also became keenly aware that others would come after me and that I needed to leave them an example of faithful endurance. I had to stand in that line and endure. We leave an example for other believers. Number 9, we are also on display for unbelievers. And this is a powerful witness because it is so costly. So prepare to be put on display. I know what this is like. I ended up on display not only for other prisoners and for my guards, but eventually before all of Turkey and even before millions around the world. I love what the prophet Daniel says about those living in the most difficult times, times like we will face. "But the people who know their God shall stand firm and take action." If you know your God, you shall stand firm. This is what I've been emphasizing, knowing our God. If you want to stand firm, then know your God. And God is certainly interested in our standing firm, but He actually wants us to go beyond this. God's people will stand firm and take action. Some translate it as, they will stand firm and carry out great exploits. So we're meant not merely to survive in times of pressure, we're also meant to carry out assignments for God. But first, we have to stand. If we don't stand, then God won't be able to use us. So prepare to be on display. We are children of light. Light shines in the darkness. It's on display. And those who want to escape the growing darkness will know whom to go to for life. They will come to us. This brings me to the last result I want to emphasize, number 10. Those who endure persecution will be greatly rewarded for eternity. We tend to de-emphasize reward. Maybe one reason is that we don't want to appear to be motivated by personal gain. The common picture is that we'll receive a crown and then cast it down at the feet of Jesus. But the Bible doesn't actually teach this. Jesus emphasizes reward. He urges us to live in such a way as to gain this reward. And to those who suffer persecution, he says, "Your reward will be great." What we do here really does matter for eternity. There are people who are famous in this life who are not known in heaven. And there are people no one has heard of in this life who are sitting next to Jesus, and they're greatly honored. We may not care about reward and honor now, but I think this is because of our ignorance. We don't realize how important it is to God. But we will greatly value it throughout eternity. And the measure of reward is linked directly to how we handle persecution. Peter writes, "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in various trials, so that the proven character of your faith, more precious than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Jesus will honor those who prove their faithfulness in difficulty. Perhaps one of the rewards in eternity is a greater closeness, a greater intimacy with Jesus. I've come to understand that my time in prison was very precious to God. Someone said to me early on, "Andrew, now it's just you and God. It's going to be great." It didn't feel great to me. It didn't feel to me that God was with me. But as I look back, I can see that he really appreciated, he cherished this time as I offered my devotion, my worship, my obedience, my love to him in very difficult circumstances. It was a very precious time to God. And as I look back, it was also a very precious time to me. It didn't feel good. It was very difficult. But I wouldn't trade what I have gained from it. It's mine for eternity. A friend told me recently, Jesus will not be unequally yoked to his bride. And I think this is true. Jesus is going to have a bride to whom he will be equally yoked. A bridegroom who has suffered will have a bride who has also suffered. And because she has suffered, she'll be a pure bride, purified in the fires of faithful obedience, a bride whose heart is close to his, who bears his image, who lives to please him, who has proven her love and allegiance. This will be a bride worthy of her beloved. In concluding this series, I want to leave you with a final thought. There's a great line from a book I read in prison. "To do right is always worth it. Not always today, but always tomorrow." This is the heavenly perspective. Noreen told me during some very dark times in prison, "If we go through this the right way, at the end, we will have no regrets." When she said this, she didn't know whether I would gain my freedom in this life or not. She was pointing me to what really matters. Be faithful. Be obedient. Run the race well. He is worthy and he is worth it. As we look back now, I can say that we have no regrets. Of course, I know my race is not over yet. So I focus on running the race that is set before me now, to finish well, to be found worthy to stand before Jesus on that final day with no regrets. And I pray the same for you.